Hi, it's me. My question is sort of related to Jennifer's in a sort of odd way. First, there are two questions. First, do you think there's a way that section could be rewritten so it wasn't arbitrary, or in a way that would be constitutional? Like, for example, one of my concerns about it doesn't have to do with the gross abuse of authority or any of those things. It has to do with a purely economic concern that if you have 25 wives and 79 children, and one of the wives would like to divorce you, or whatever you want to call it, and move out with her children, how the hell are you going to be able to support that person because you've got 79 other children or whatever to support? And so I consider that a problem. And it means that people will stay in those relationships even when it's not in their best interest, right? So if we were to recast the law to say one cannot marry more than three people, or one must be economically able to support it, or how can we rewrite it so that what I consider a significant harm, actually, of that type of a union, and I'm not saying that you couldn't have somebody who doesn't work, say, for example, and therefore can't support their children. You know, there's other situations, right, that can result in that too. But I'm just, that is one of the concerns, and sort of an almost undescribable concern, again, that could exist in other types of relationship, is how does one dad have a relationship with 79 children? And I know there could be absentee fathers or people who are split up and so on, but I mean, I just think the it's impossible, actually, in that type, in the nature, in the exponential nature of those people involved.
I mean, I can accept all those pressing social concerns for which, you know, the state needs to you know, carefully consider what are some ways to provide education, provide avenues of exit. I don't think that criminalizing relationships based on the number of persons is a suitable way to do that. I think then you have to get into actually well-established information about the actual deterrent effect of criminal law. What is it? You know, how much can you actually hope to influence people's choices? And in terms of the economic viability, that opens up a real can of worms, yeah, with respect to just the, you know, absolute right to parent. And
yeah,
if we want to go down that road, we can, but A, not through the criminal law, and B, not just in the context of plural relationships.
I had a question actually about the type of argument that you made about arbitrary laws. Where do you think the line should be drawn, and should there be a line drawn at all?
Yeah.
And the case that I'm thinking of is the decriminalization of incest argument that's going on in Switzerland right now.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, we can apply, yeah, the same arguments.
Yeah, and I think the incest argument is fair game. I think it's fair game, because if you look at the Canadian laws, which are the Canadian cases that have dealt with incest, it's very much been focused on parent-child incest, not sibling, talking about the abuse of power there, and very much focused on the genetics difficulty, which I think is a reasonable... that's not arbitrary. If that's your reason for example, criminalizing incest between a parent and child, and
well, they could make the argument that it's between consenting adults.
Sorry, for those who aren't familiar with the case, could you just give them?
Yeah,
background?
I'll do a little more background.
Yeah.
Well, I think Switzerland has just moved to decriminalize incest. In part, they're saying that the genetic basis for incest is no longer support, or doesn't merit the use of the criminal law. I don't know. I haven't investigated that. But these kinds of the laws that I characterized as really evoking this kind of visceral response, they are open to question using this framework of arbitrariness. They're not necessarily going to be found to be arbitrary. But I think it's a helpful reference point to use, especially with laws that just seem to have always been with us, prohibitions, taboos that have always been with us. And we should be willing to look at them in terms of their history, and in terms of polygamy. I mean, it wasn't prosecuted for six decades.
It's surely not because there was no polygamy occurring in Canada. I mean, that in itself evinces some kind of change in the cultural attitude and or in the willingness to devote particular resources to, you know, to those kinds of prosecutions. So is there line drawing that will have to happen in some cases? Yes. Will some of that line drawing potentially be arbitrary? Yes. You know, and as much as that's anathema to me, I mean, you have to live in the real world. But in this context, I think the argument that this law is arbitrary is really, I think it's inescapable.
My question is, historically known models of family were either one and one model or one and many model. And there never was many and many model.
Right.
And if not gender specific, like if both men and women
right.
are allowed to have multiple spouses,
right.
not prosecuted for that,
right.
then the situation when, for example, okay, let's assume one man marries two women and they are all three perfectly happy. And at some moment of time, one of his wives decided to marry another man.
Yes.
Should he join those three? Or it will be a separate family?
Yeah.
So it will totally deconstruct the institution of family as it exists and as it existed. So if polygamy is allowed, or at least not prosecuted.
Well, and those are two very, I mean, if polygamy is no longer prosecuted, we will still have quite a vigorous debate before us about the legalization question and the degree to which the state, outside of the criminal law context, can privilege certain forms of certain relationships, and the way that we structure responsibilities and choice and consent in the context of those relationships. I agree; those are important questions. I don't think the possibility of confronting those questions justifies Section 293.
I'm trying desperately to remember my first year constitution stuff, but if I recall, it was Big M that said the government can't have a shifting purpose. You can't say it's now this is really what we did the reason for it, even though originally it was just because we hate Mormons. Is that on its own enough to get rid of 293, or does the 1955 reformulation get rid of that argument?
It's an open question. I think the evidence would show that the purpose did not shift. Just because of the, first of all, it's part of an overall modernization initiative, so the entire criminal code was overhauled, and just because where they have the strongest argument is the removal of the particular reference to the polygamy. You can just as easily say that was perhaps a recognition that having it be so blatant was outdated, was somewhat embarrassing, but still very much focused on the primacy of monogamous or one-on-one marriage, in part because of, you know, a commitment to a certain religious, social, cultural belief that I think could still betray animus against certain groups. So I think it's an open question. It's certainly not as neat and clean as if we still had the original 278, but the evidence for that purpose, I'm not convinced that the evidence.
United Nations, in their Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, has recommended to all countries that they ban polygamy. So in light of this recommendation by the United Nations, I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on if Canada decriminalizes this, how the United Nations will view us, and or perhaps how other countries will.
Yeah, it's a comment or feint. Like, do we really want to be the first country to decriminalize polygamy? As if, and that it will put us, you know, as a bit of an outlier. I mean, I don't find that a particularly persuasive argument. Now, in terms of the United Nations argument around banning polygamy, again, I think that's an overbroad recommendation. And I think it's subject to the same criticisms I've made as to the utility of a criminal ban that is focused on the number of parties that are present in an intimate relationship. So, I mean, my response would simply be, I think that the ban as it's found in the international conventions or the international documents is properly subject to critique. The other part, it's a political question, right? And we can't avoid dealing with it as a political question, but because it also involves the criminal law, we have very deep questions of principle that we must be willing to uphold.
My question would be surrounding the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, and my understanding of that sort of being the supreme framework or blueprint for how we organize ourselves in our country. And how I see this is how we structure our relationships. So again, structure would be the key word for me. So how is that structuring of our relationships established in the Charter of Rights and Freedoms? And where would that be included? And is it evident to us, or is that something that's missing? And again, I'll just use some analogies from business. For instance, oil and gas. There's many types of relationship structures that are required to be effective in organizing life or business resources or whatever. And so we very easily do it in that realm. But when we come to our personal relationship structures, we seem to maybe lack some creativity, and I just see it coming in the future, pressure to determine what is really a right or a freedom around how you structure your relationships. So is it included in the charter?
No, it's not. I mean, the charter very much is a product of classical liberalism. The majority of it is based on a principle of non-interference with the rational, autonomous individual. There are, though, sections of the charter, and the charter is very worded in very broad terms. There are sections of the charter that would seem to imply a fair amount of latitude to make those kinds of decisions. It was pointed out to me yesterday, and I hadn't actually thought about this before, freedom of association. Mm-hmm. There isn't a lot of support in the jurisprudence for that aspect of association, but I think absolutely, when you're talking about the criminal law, there is an implication of freedom of association. There's an implication, implication with respect to religious belief, and religious beliefs that might compel you to form a certain kind of family in a certain way. And there's the basic liberty to make fundamental life choices that cannot be, for which you cannot then be put at risk of being sent to jail by a law that is arbitrary, right? And so in Manuel Levine, the court said smoking marijuana is not a fundamental personal decision, it's a lifestyle choice. But I think if faced with the issue of the choice of how you construct your family, I think absolutely that would be seen as a fundamental life choice. And there's a secondary part of Section 7, which is what I'm talking about, regarding security of the person. So they're there, they're latent, they don't on their face strictly relate to these kinds of personal relationships and these communal kinds of interests. The Charter wasn't originally drafted with that in mind, but they absolutely are there.